So what I'm thinking of covering today was starting off with linear regression. The way I wanted to structure it is by giving small intuition and starting with the entire concept of machine learning and very basics of machine learning. And meanwhile, also cover some part of data cleansing and all. Those are the standard steps we'll do. The data cleaning, data preparation, data visualization before every step, before any algorithm we use. So I thought instead of going through the same thing again on data cleansing, data visualization, data preparation, I thought let's get started with this. And anyways, you'll be doing it so many times that you won't require any revision of this. So I've put up all this material on the week 5. Go through it after this session. Well, with that, let's get started with. Also, I'm seeing quite a lot of people on waiting room. So if I lose my focus and I'm not able to see anyone who's on wait, please stop me and ask them to admit. Otherwise, some people might be left out. Okay, so I wanted to start with linear regression. This is by far the workhorse of the core of statistics and machine learning. It has been with us for centuries, not decades, but centuries. This was the mainstay and still is the mainstay. And some of the principles that I want to discuss while talking about machine learning would stay core to your entire machine learning journey.
Guys, a small request. Can everybody please put themselves on mute except the speaker?
Thanks. Okay, so agenda for today is I'll spend some time giving an introduction to machine learning and a little bit of what artificial intelligence is, some concepts which are very core to machine learning, and regardless of the method and model you would use, you'll always do certain things. I would discuss those, then touch base on the linear regression theory. And take up a small toy example and then run through the regression model. Second week, we'll do something similar but a little more advanced. Okay. Okay, so what do we mean? Again, I think I've covered this, but let's do it a little more deeper this time. What do you mean when you say machine learning? So it involves a machine which learns, but what do we mean when we say learn? Think of it in human terms on what do you mean by learning when we talk about our own selves. So we look at the world, we learn from it, create a mental map or a mental model of how things work. So it might be anything simple, like first time when you see a gas stove, you would not know whether it's dangerous for you to touch it when it's on or not. Once you touch it, you get an instant feedback, and then you have created a model that if you see it burning, don't touch it. And perhaps later, when you can generalize this model to multiple other things, that anything with fire on it is perhaps your body is not going to like it. It's going to cause pain. So you have developed a mental model there, and this model keeps evolving as and when you see more of the world. And what do these models do? It helps in your decision making to touch something or not, how to be cautious. This helps you in your decision making. It's exactly the same way how machine learning also fundamentally works. You have a view of the world, but this view is by precise data. When I say precise, now even before I go into precision, data can be of any format. It might be numbers, it might be tabular. It might be speech, it might be images, it can be anything. But for our algorithms, this needs to be precise. Precise in sense, it needs to be measured. So when we say it rained, when we as humans, we talk about rain, we would not be as precise. We would generally say it rained a lot. It rained somewhat more. It rained less. Because of our heuristics, we would have learn to interpret these. But for a computer, for you to teach your computer, you would need your data to be precise. That means when you say, when you talk about any measurement, rain or hotness of something, you would want it to be measured. Degrees of or units of measurement doesn't matter as long as you're measuring it in a precise way. So it has to be 25 centimeter rainfall, 3 degree Kelvin, 40 degree Celsius, something like that. Now this data is presented to a computer, and what it does is, same way as you prepare a mental model, it prepares a summary which describes of machine's understanding of the world. Now this summary, using precise data, is mathematical in nature. So it creates a mathematical model. Imagine it as a summary which describes the view of the world to it. And then it helps a decision making. This in summary is machine learning. There might be a lot of fancy terms out there, but at the core of it, this is what I believe what is crux of machine learning. Now, why do we need that? Machine learning is the part which automates this model making. So once you give a data to a machine, what makes it so powerful is this entire part of creating a math model using precise data has been automated. And this is at the heart of machine learning. Until now, we used to have very experienced people with long white beards, with PhDs, calling themselves mathematicians and statisticians, poring for years together over data and then preparing these models. That was the approach till now. That is a statistical and a mathematical approach to something. Machine learning approach is more of, we have thousands of models available to us on libraries. Now what machine learning tries to do is fit a model to the given data. Now this is the fundamental difference between statistics and machine learning. Statistics arrives at a model looking at data by doing various sort of mathematical tests. Machine learning would have lot of models and try to select a model which best fits the data. And because it's an iterative, repetitive, and predictable process, it can be automated. And this, in sense, is machine learning. Let's talk about it in a little more concrete way. So imagine you have a tabular set of data. I'm just taking a very, very simple toy example. It would be a tabular data around prices and sales. So it might be any data. Now, it plotted on x-axis and y-axis, it gives some random dots, each dot representing a particular row in this table. So this might be price and sales corresponding to this row. Now what a algorithm would do is try to put a line through it or try to identify a pattern here. Now this line is a pattern. Now it can be anything. So this line is a summary which computer has decided that is the best representation of this data. This line is the summary. So this part is where we are summarizing things, right? So this summary can be many, many types. So you can summarize it by saying sales is sales, regardless price. Let's just take an average of all the sales and call it as our summary. So regardless of the price of an item, sales would stay constant and you would call it that would be an average of all the sales. And that's your mental model. So as you have seen, that's a very, very simplistic view of the world, that regardless of the price, your sales is going to stay constant. There is some degree of variation, but that's just purely random or accidental in nature. And you have created a model which is just sales bar. That means average of all sales. This is what this computer has given, that this is the best possible summarization of this data. As you would see, the various models gives various different type of summaries, and we have methods to evaluate amongst all the summaries possible which summary is the best. And that is the entire concept of how machine learning makes things so much easier, because we can now build millions of these summaries and then have a program decide which summary is the best representation of the world. So in this case, this is the summary. So what computer says is sales is mostly price 0.9 times the price plus one. Now with this, now I can help my decision making. So given a price, can I predict sales? I just have to plug this in and arrive at sales. So what we will try to do in this session is understand some of these summary generation techniques. In specific, we will try to arrive at one specific type of summary like this line called a linear regression. We will see how computer generates it, what is the intuition behind it, and how do we know that this summary, what summary is the best summary, and we'll try to understand how does it work. So when I spoke about taking data and learning about the world from it, now what in essence are we doing? So we have some amount of information from, for some amount of data from the past, and what we are trying to do is predict future. Now, when I say I use data from the past to infer the future, I'm not taking this definition in a very tight bounded way that yesterday it rained, so it will rain tomorrow. Think of it in a loosely coupled sense that there is something in the past that allows us to predict to a certain degree what is in future. Now think of data as having two elements to it. A part of data has information in it and some noise. Now information part is usually what is repeatable. It repeats itself. Noise is something very random by its very definition and does not repeat. So when we have data from the past, what these summaries are trying to do is extract this information, distill away the noise, and because this information would repeat itself, try to predict future, and then add some random noise to it to make it a very reliable estimate of the future. But here, one thing to notice is this noise and this noise would not be same. Noise does not have pattern to it. Noise is just random in nature. It would not repeat. It's very abstract notion. So if I have to think on how to concretely put it, I think there are multiple ways, multiple people try to explain it. I would recommend you Google it for yourself as well. Here is the approach I am taking. So let's say there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 days. And X represents days on which it did not rain. Y represents days on which it rained. Now, if this is the data for past 14 days and I want to extract some information out of it and try to predict future, I would think of information as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 5 times out of 14 was the percentage chances of rain. So which comes up to 35.7% chance of rain. What is noise? Is thinking of it as it rains 2nd, 6th, 8th, 12th and 13th day. And hence, in the next half of the month, it would rain on the 17th day and 15 plus 6, 21st day and so on and so forth. That would be noise. So if you're flipping a coin, if you flip it 10 times and let's say just pure randomness, 7 times it was head, 3 times it was tail. Now the information content is perhaps the coin might be biased. It gives 70% weightage to heads and 30% to the tails. But what would be noise is let's say last time it was heads. It doesn't mean that every 3 times there is heads, next 7 times would be tails because of this percentage. That's noise. So what we're trying to do is identify information and distill away the noise from it. And that's what we would attempt at and try to do. Okay, so why is it difficult? What makes it so difficult? First thing, what makes machine learning so trivial is difficult is, one, as I said, all the information data that we have would always have a component of noise, and this noise is mixed with information. Often it's very technical and difficult to separate these two, and that's what makes it a little difficult, and that's why we would need some aid of computation and algorithms to do it for us. And it's always a challenge to identify the information content. What exactly is the information? What part of it is just random in nature? And then to do this properly and to see if we are doing things in a right way, wrong way, there is a notion of something called a test train split. So if there is, in fact, let me draw this for you. Okay, so think of our data as a table. So I'll take the same example for easy recall, price and sales. It would have multiple rows of data. Now, what we do generally is, we randomly take some rows out of this data and keep it outside. So let's take this row 1, row 2, row 10, row 12. Now this has to be total random choice. We should not, I'll come to explanation why. So this random set would divide this into two parts. One is called a test set. One is called a train set. Now, both of this is same data. So this data is train plus test. Whatever we predict, whatever algorithms we do, we would do all our operations in something known as a train data set. Now, once we are sure that we have identified a good summary of whatever data we have, we would use that summary to predict the data we take from train. So let's say we have multiple prices and sales. We arrive at a summary and it says sales is equal to 10 times price plus 1.2. Now from test set, we again would have all the prices and sales. What we would do is we'll feed in all the prices from the test set to this summary, and then see what is the sales that is predicted and compare this sales to the actual sales. So let's call this SCAP. So we will compare our predicted sales with the actual sales and see what is the error rate. So we'll do it for each of the rows, and then we will arrive at a figure which allows us to measure how good the predictions has been. If this error is too large, it would mean that our model has not been able to summarize it well. Ideally, we would want our errors to be low. Now, this is one notion I wanted you to be clear about. What is a test set? What is the train set? Regardless what algorithm we use from now, we would always, first thing that we do is, after cleaning and pre-processing our data, we'll break it into two different parts. One part set aside for testing purposes. The other part is where we will do all our experiments, all our algorithms, and we will use tests to evaluate how good this summary generated by the algorithm is. So this is one way where we can find out how good our models has been. Second thing is, the notion of underfit, overfit. I'm just discussing these jargons because unknowingly I might use it in future, and this is standard lingo of any data scientist. So I want to clear away what would I mean when I talk about testing and split, and when I talk about underfitting and overfitting. Okay, so what is underfitting? What is overfitting? Same example. We have our prices here and we have our sales. This is from our toy example. So let's say it had a pattern like this. Now all of these are various points. So for this price, this has been the sales. For this price, this has been the sales. So one way of summarizing it is calling a average of all sales and saying that that has been the sales. Other way is drawing a line through the data and saying that is the, this is what is the summary of it. Now, let's say when we divide it into test and train, you would arrive at, I'll draw it clean. Let's say this is your test data. Now this is where your algorithm is trying to predict. Now if it just says that sales is sales regardless what, and average of sales is what I call as a summary, and this is what determines the sales. So if we use this model, regardless of the price I'm going to use, I'll always have only one prediction for sales, and that's going to be average sales. Now this is a case of what we call underfit, where we are not modeling all the information that we have. So we had quite a lot of information. We have not used all of it. So all of these dots is information plus noise. We have not been using all the possible information to model it. And that is called an underfitting, where the model is way too simple and it did not model all the available information. The other end of it would be a model which would do something like this. So imagine a model fits a curve so precisely, so perfectly, that it has ended up capturing every possible scenario. So this is how a model would fit a curve to your data. Now, if we put now test data, so test price, and we take test prices now and then try to use this curve for prediction. So this is how the test prices were. Now, if you see, this is very similar to the band that we saw of prices and sales. It's just that we chose only specific elements. These ended up in our trained data set and the model has fitted these. And when we put our test elements to see the correctness of it, now our model cannot predict it. So for this test point, let's say the price was 10, but the prediction is going to be this. This is a typical case of overfitting, where we have modeled not only the information content, but we have also modeled the noise along with it. We have overlearned. We should not have modeled the noise. And that's what, as you would see, how do I admit someone?
I have a question.
Sure.
So basically, if underfit, that means we are not using many variables, and overfit means there are too many variables that's being used while modeling, right?
Well, that's one way of thinking it. What I would say is, even when we use all the variables, mm-hmm. it would underfit if you are not using them properly.
Okay.
And if we if we use a very complex model and for every particular price, we arrive exactly at the sales, and then we are fitting a curve to it. This is called overlearning or overfit. In this case, as you would see, this is the actual price. This is coming from test because we kept it aside. Now we want to use this curve to predict. So what would this curve predict? For this price 10, it would predict the sales of this point when actual sales was this. So this is the error.
Error, okay.
Correct? So now, as opposed to this, let's say we take a mean path. We neither underfit nor overfit. We draw a line like this. Now what would... Here also there is some gap. The actual sales was this, but now it predicts this as sales. But you would say this error is much lesser than the previous overfitted model.
Okay.
So the fundamental thing about machine learning, one is identify information and discard noise. This is the primary challenge. All these algorithm curve fitting would be automated by the algorithms. But how do you do this is still within your control. So this is going to be a design choice and a very, very difficult choice. Second most difficult thing would be the measure of these errors. How do we measure these errors and then arrive at? So again, for the same example, we have these as our data points. Now we can draw multiple lines through it. Which line is the best? Is line 1 the best? Is line 2 the best? Line 3 the best? So we would need to tell our algorithms a way to quantify the goodness of each line. So the goodness, each line, you remember, each line is nothing but a summary of the world. Because of all the data that you have provided to your algorithm, algorithm summarizes your entire data into one simple mathematical model. Now these lines are those mathematical models. It can be very complicated. It need not be a straight line, but for linear regression models, these are going to be straight lines. So linear regression mathematical models would always be straight lines. Now we need to decide, we need a way to decide which line is the right line. So these two are the design choices we will be talking in today's session. Okay, so that being machine learning, two types of machine learning. There are actually three types. 99.99% of times, only two types of machine learning are used. Just for sake of completeness, I'll discuss the third one. But this is what I've already covered. So think of these as, in this data set, whenever you have a data set where you have something that is to be predicted and you have quite a lot of variables which are predictors. Predictors in sense, things that help you predict. So in our case, predictors were price and predicted was sales. Let's say you have a data set which gives a person's age, his occupation, and his position, and you're trying to predict salary. In this case, salary becomes predicted, age, occupation, and position becomes predictors. Predictors are also known as features. Now, this is a term which you will and I will most standardly use to refer to predictors. We will call it features. As we will see that why are these called features? Because these are the things which would help us predict predictor, not only in their native format, but also we can do some engineering and some clever techniques around it. So is a combination of position plus age a better determinant of salary than age and position looked at in a separate way? So these kind of things are called feature engineering. We can engineer features out of existing features and be able to arrive at our algorithms, be able to strengthen our algorithms. Okay, with the jargon and all understood, supervised learning is when we have inputs and desired outputs. Desired output is the predictor. So when we have a labeled data, it's also called labeled data when we have predictors present. So the all the examples we have seen so far are supervised. Because we have labels on them, because we have something called ground truth. So predicted, whatever data is predicted, like sales, salary, all those are also known as ground truth or labels or desired output. All these things would mean the same. When we don't have those, it is called unsupervised. Now I'll come to an example of unsupervised as well. Because we have this data, it's easy to compare models in supervised, and we don't have any simple evaluation and comparison methods in unsupervised learning. Regression and classification, these are two types of supervised learning. So if we just had data on okay, so let's say I do quite a lot of analytics on my website. I just have a lot of data on who visits my website, when do they visit, do they visit from mobile phone or do they visit from here. So you would see where they're coming from. They're coming from a direct reference, they're coming from a referral, social media or organic search, which means this traffic, these people are coming directly by searching my website, and all the other ways. It also tells me which country they are coming from. So this is right now people on the website. So you have some people, let's say 2 from Russia, 5 from Canada, 18 from United States, 6 from Australia, 1 from Brazil. It tells me which page they are in and how many people are on which page. Number of active users decayed over time. It tells me how many, so are they visiting from desktop, mobile or a tablet. There are quite a lot of other reports that can be generated. So what I'm trying to say is, in this sort of data is unsupervised because we don't have anything that is getting predicted. So I just have data which says country, device, what page do they land on, or how do they come to my website. It might be via referral, organic, or direct search things. How long do they stay on my website? So I just have a collection of data. Now, what do I want to do? I want to model something. I want to group certain type of users. Let's say people coming from India who have found my website from LinkedIn and staying 2 minutes or more on a particular page are more likely to respond to my emails than rest of others. So I want to group all of these people together. It's think of it just like a multiple filters. It's going to be much more complicated than that, but I'm just giving a toy example. In here, I don't have anything called a predicted or a predictor. I'm using all the variables to group or categorize people into multiple groups. Now, these type of problems are unsupervised. Now here in our earlier example, we found that we could always measure between a distance between a difference between actual value and predicted value, and this would give a score of error. This allowed us to measure how good a model is or how bad a model is. In unsupervised learning, that all is not possible because we don't have any measure. But there are various techniques we would cover later to figure out which model is better. So with that, I think I've covered types of machine learning. Okay, now we jump on to linear regression. I would deviate away from slides now and mostly rely on explaining some concepts behind linear regression and then pick up an example to run through these. Okay, and we'll keep referring back to this slide so that I'm sure we have not forgotten. So the reason why I did skip the entire statistical part was my belief that anyways you are going to use statistics in understanding a model, let's start creating models and understand whatever statistics, mathematics and coding is involved in that. So this is going to be my approach for this session onwards. Okay, let's talk about linear regression. Before I talk about linear regression, what does linear mean? I'll remove this if it is too distracting. Okay, so what does a linear relationship mean? Linear regression means only in very simple terms means association, a linear association between any set of variables. In our case, it was a price versus sales. Let's stick through that. So if there are any variables, let's say X and Y, if data looks like this, we call it a positive association. If X increases, so does Y. In the same way, if I draw a set of data which looks like this instead, now this is called a negative association. If X increases, Y decreases. Or I won't call it if X increases, I'll call when X increases, Y decreases. So X1, X2. X2 is greater than X1. So X has increased, but Y has correspondingly decreased. This is called a negative relation. And something like this, this is not related. So there is no linear association between X and Y. You cannot say if X increases, Y increases, or when Y decreases, X tends to decrease. Now this gives a good notion or sets up us to understand how do we measure this. So remember I said we need precise data. Same is with everything. We need something to be precise and mathematical to understand it. Let's try understanding how do we arrive. So what I'm going to discuss is something all of you would have studied in your 8th and 9th grade. But I'm going to arrive, so early, perhaps the approach which is used in 8th and 9th grades while teaching correlations, covariations and standard deviation is they give you a formula and then set of data ask you to calculate it. I am going to try to arrive at those formulas using graphs and build an intuition around it and take it to linear regression from there. So at any point of time, if any of you are not clear on what I'm talking about, please feel free to interrupt and ask questions. So same X and Y, we'll take same type of data. This is the data. Now, this is how the data looks. Let's try taking an average of all the X. So this might be X1, X2, X3, X4, X5, so on and so forth until Xn. We are averaging. We are just putting some mark in middle. So this is X bar. I'm going to denote average of X by X bar. Same way of all the possible values of Y, I'm going to take a mark which is right in middle. This is average of Y. If we draw two lines, we have divided this into four parts. Anything to the right of this line, anything to the right of this line is greater than the average of X. Anything above this line is greater than average of Y. Same way, this is lesser than the average of Y. This part is lesser than average of X. Now, it allows us some curious properties. Now, let's call it quadrant 1, quadrant 2, quadrant 3, quadrant 4. If we see in quadrant 1, the term X minus X bar, what would it be, positive or negative? You would always have an X which is greater than x bar because it's towards the right. So this will always be positive in quadrant one. Same way, y minus y bar, if we measure, this is a particular point x, y. This y is higher definitely because it's above, it's definitely higher than y bar. So this is positive. So for a figure x minus x bar multiplied by y minus y bar would always be positive because it's sum of two positive terms. If we take quadrant three, for any point x and y, x minus x bar would always be negative because this x is on the left side of x bar. Same way, y minus y bar would always be negative because this y is smaller than this y bar. And if we multiply these two, negative times negative would always be positive. So in this quadrant and this quadrant, this figure of x minus x bar times y minus y bar would always be positive. In these quadrants, it will always be negative because let's say quadrant two, there is some random point x and y. X minus x bar would be negative because x on is on the left side, but y minus y bar is positive because y is this point is above this line. Some multiplication of negative times positive would yield a negative. So this, all the dots here have negative sign to a term x minus x bar times y minus y bar. Same way, quadrant four, for any term xy, x minus x bar would be positive because x is on the right side, but y minus y bar would be negative because it's below this average. One is positive, one side of this equation is negative. That's why the entire part becomes negative. So with this, what I'm trying to say is, for any set of data, if we calculate x minus x bar times y minus y bar for every point, this point, this point, this point, every point in data, if it is positive, then the data is spread between quadrant three and quadrant one. That means it starts this way and moves this way. If it is negative, that means it is distributed in this way between quadrant two and quadrant four. So this allows us to a notion that anything that is spread this way would have x minus x bar times y minus y bar, which is positive, and hence are positively correlated, because visually we can see that if x increases, y also increases. This is called a positive correlation. Anything drawn like this is negative correlation. Now we intuitively understand by drawing bars on what is correlation. So that leads us to the formula of, if we were to take this around this particular equation for every possible data, sum it over and take an average. So if there are m points, if there are n points, if we average it over all the n points, we arrive at a figure called covariance of x to y. Now this is the formula which is generally taught in 8th and 9th, that covariance of x with y is summation of x minus x bar y minus y bar. Now you understand why it is like that. Until this part, are you guys all clear?
Fine,
bro.
Yeah.
Okay. So let's verify the formula. X minus x bar, y minus y bar, n. And here it also says n minus 1 sample covariance, and this is for population. Now this is very nuanced and more for a statistical approach that we, this has something to do with degrees of freedom. If someone is really interested, I'm going to put out material on what this difference is, but most of the data in machine learning is going to be large. So even for very small data set with, let's say, 1,000 points, it's not much of a difference if you divide it by 1,000 or 999. So I'll just ignore this subtlety here, but you need not worry about this. Okay, now we understand what covariance is. Covariance that typically means if we have got two variables, X and Y, if one increases, covariance would give whether the other variable also increases or decreases. Now, what is the problem with covariance? Now, as you see, one of the fundamental challenges with covariance is covariance has also, so covariance is the formula of covariance is remarkably similar to something called a variance. Now, variance gives a spread of any data. It's on a single set of data. So if I'm given data, if I given multiple points, I want to find a variance. It is just sum of all the points from their own mean squared divided by n. So it can also be thought of covariance of the variable with itself, because these y's, if you converted it to y into x and x into x bar, it becomes exactly the same as this. So think of variance as spread of a data within itself, how widely the data is spread, and covariance is how is the data spread because of something else. Okay, that was just a curious observation. It's a I wish they taught it in school, but that's what variance is. Now, the problem with covariance and why we cannot use it is covariance has units attached to it. So covariance of X and Y tells me if X increases, Y also increases, or Y decreases. Covariance is essentially that figure that tells me. But this figure would be, so because the formula is something like this, imagine your X was price. In our case, X was price and Y was sales. Let's say sales was in thousands of dollars, but price was in cents, because we're selling something really small. Now, because of this, the units of this is cents times dollars. So this is in essence something that is dependent on scale of this thing. Instead of this, if we were to take only tens of dollars and this instead of cents, we take, let's say, pounds, sterling pounds or rupees, this number, the resultant number would change. Or if we are trying to predict, if we are trying to draw a relation between sales and number of hours spent selling things, now the units become hours times dollars, and your figure, whatever the resulting figure from this equation, would change. So because it's unit and scale dependent, it makes comparison of this covariance figure between two different things very difficult. So to overcome that problem, mathematicians arrived at something remarkably simple and incredibly powerful. So if we take covariance and divide it by standard deviation of X and standard deviation of Y, we get rid of units. This unit was cents times dollars. Standard deviation of X would always be in cents. Standard deviation of Y would be in dollars. These two cancel out, and the resultant number is neither dependent on scale now nor dependent on any unit. We just have a pure number. Now, remarkable property of these numbers is now it is comparable. So we have something between minus 1 and positive 1, which can be absolutely relied on as a single measure of how strong is this relation. How strong is the relation between x and y? So if x goes up by, let's say, 10%, how much percent does y go up or down by? Now this figure allows you to calculate that. And that is what is called a correlation coefficient. So because we have this property now, we can actually compare different things. If it has been really long since you have visited any of the statistics, go through this particular part once more, and I think it would be much more clearer. So with this definition of correlation coefficient, we have something to measure a linear association between x and y. Okay, I want to test a simple thing. This is my data, x and y. Now, question to all of you guys would be, after going through all of this, what is the coefficient of correlation between x and y? Any guess?
Zero.
Perfect. Our x and y, so there is the coefficient of correlation is zero. So what we have said earlier is, do you mean to say there is no relation between x and y? So here is the fundamental difference. What this zero tells is there is no linear relationship between x and y. Of course, there is a relationship. What do you mean by a relationship? Given any point x, can I predict y? Of course, yes. This is plain circle. If you give me this point on the circumference, I can always predict y. Equation of circle is this. If this is a radius of 1, x square plus y square is equal to 1. So give any x and I will be able to tell you y. So there is a definite relationship. But what this coefficient, what we saw coefficient of correlation tells us is if the relation is linear or not. Because we are studying linear regression, we would use this coefficient of regression, which tells us linear relation, the strength of linear relationship between x and y. And once we get a hang around it, later we'll add non-linearities to it. So even if there is no linear relationship, how do we still predict these kind of non-linearities? So I digress from the topic by discussing this for a bit, because I wanted to be clear that when I speak about relationships, these are linear relationships which I'm talking about. Okay, so I think this sets up nicely for our deck. Where is it? Okay, so linear relationship.
One quick question.
Yes.
So when you are saying you are going to work on this linear regression, so only we are going to talk about the two variables?
No, so we can talk about multiple variables. What I showed as an example, because it was easier for me to draw on a graph, we took only two variables. But usually, you would never, if you had only two variables, you can solve it on paper. You would not require algorithms and anything to do it.
Yeah. Okay.
So you can typically do it on a Excel all the time. So usually we have hundreds of these features in a typical machine learning environment. You would have quite a lot of these predictors or features and something that is to be predicted. So single variable, the relationship between only two variables is called a univariate linear regression. If you have multiple variables, you call it a multivariate linear regression. Okay. So I think I've covered linear relationship. What is a linear relationship between variables? Okay, here to again make my point a little stronger. What happened? To again make my point a little stronger, what I wanted to show you were these. So this diagram, if data looks like this, it has a perfect positive correlation. X goes up by 1%, so does Y. That means we have a perfect correlation of plus 1. Same way, this type of spread, negative 1. If it's a little dispersed but generally slanting downwards, it wouldn't be perfect negative 1, but it might be somewhere in the negative range. A very symmetrical one, 0. Now, see this line. Now, what do you think? There is a definite positive relation between X and Y. But what do you think is the coefficient for this? I've left it blank intentionally. What is the coefficient of correlation for this? Now, for some data sets, it's going to be undefined because coefficient of correlation, as we discussed, was X minus X bar times Y minus Y bar. Now, if you plot an x-axis, y-axis. Now you see y and y bar are going to be the same, and hence standard deviation would be 0. So the numerator y minus y bar part will become 0, and hence entire numerator becomes 0. Denominator would have a term, standard deviation of y, which again becomes 0 because it's not spread on y direction. It's only spread on x direction. Because there is no spread on y direction, there is no standard deviation. That means its standard deviation is also 0. 0 by 0 mathematically is something known as undefined number. So these are some of the quirks which you might encounter in your data set which is presented to you, which might break your algorithm. So it's always good because anyways we are going to follow the same steps. We first take the data, prepare it, and then visualize it. This is how visualization helps you. So if you visualize this set of data, you would immediately know this is something which might break the algorithm. And then at the bottom row, you see various distributions where we have a definite relation between X and Y, but we don't have a linear relationship and hence the coefficient is 0. So here, if I draw a plus between X-axis, Y-axis, it's spread on all four quadrants. Same way, if you draw an X and a Y coordinate, it's spread on all four coordinates. So anything symmetrical across all four coordinates is always going to have a 0 as linear coefficient. That means there is no linear relationships between them. This is very important. The idea of things having linear relationships. These are still related, but they are not related in a linear way. Okay, so if I have to let's take an example. I have some data saved with me. This is on car mileage. So let me quickly open up a Jupyter notebook. So same way as I usually open, I go to Anaconda prompt. I tab to the folder where my data is, and I can always use, because I don't want to type all these ML bootcamp, I just press tab and because here is my data, I would launch an instance of Jupyter notebook from here. Okay, this is the Jupyter notebook. Let's look at what is the data that we have. I want to use this particular data set. It doesn't render Excel properly. No worries, we can open it on an Excel. This is the data that we have. We have miles per gallon. We have number of cylinders, displacement, also known as CC. Horsepower, HP, weight of the car, acceleration, model year, origin, and you would see origin is coded 1, 2, 3, we don't know what it is. So as I said last time, every data set would have certain amount of documentation available to it. I went through the documentation and it told me one means origin is America, two is Europe, third is Japanese origin perhaps. Name of the car. And what I'm trying to ask is there a linear relationship between miles per gallon, also known as mileage, to the weight of the car? Now, because we all understand intuitively cars, everyone knows the heavier the car is, lesser the mileage would be. But we want to do it in a mathematically precise way. Also, while we are at it, you see certain things are missing. So we'll also cover all the previous steps. Load this data set. Identify some missing data things, or this is not even missing, this is deliberately kept as question mark. In real life, whatever data sets you would have would never be clean. You would either have it missing like this, a truly missing where it would be blank, or someone would have put NA, or it depends on the person who's collecting this data. They would have just put a question mark. So let's see, how do we clean all of that and then process it? Okay. In fact, let's try to do it a little more intuitively. Is this Zoom fine?
Yes, Paruthya.
Okay, so I'm going to import standard libraries, which we always import with same naming convention. NumPy as NP, Pandas as PD. This command percentage matplotlib inline is to render the graphs right within the notebook. Now, along with this, I would need some special libraries which I'm going to use for linear regression, but I'll import them when I need that. Okay, so this is all very familiar to you. You would have used it, you would know what each of these lines means. Now we are trying to read this data set, Auto MPG XLS. Okay, so I have read the data into my table. I've used a panda table, read XLS, because it was an Excel file. It gives me the same thing. MPG, cylinder, displacement, horsepower, weight. Now we notice some of the missing data in horsepower. We'll come to dealing with it when we are actually using horsepower. But for now, there is one question which was, do heavier cars have lower mileage? Let's try to figure that out. And then in process, try to understand, because now we have one variable. As Sanjeev, you were asking, how do we include multiple variables? We will progress on to adding multiple variables. Okay, let's try to add one variable. So what am I trying to do? I'm trying to figure out if there is a relationship between this and this. What is the best way to do that? Instead of all the mathematical jargon, computation of numbers and all, let's try to do it as humans do it best. Let's try to plot this visually. SNS, I want a scatter plot. So what do I want? MPG on x-axis and weight on y-axis. And my data is, well, let's call it data. Data input this. I put a scatter plot with MPG, miles per gallon on x-axis, and wind. Now there is definite relationship between this, right? Because we see a trend. There is something. It all moves this way. So generally it says as weight goes down, as miles per gallon, so as weight increases, so weight, if this is the weight, my miles per gallon is 40. If I increase the weight to this point, my miles per gallon decreases. So there is an inverse relationship. As I earlier showed, if it was this way, from this corner to this corner, if data pointed this way, generally it is a positive association. And if this way, it's negative association. And we can infer from this. So for this point, for weight, something like 2250, whatever the scale is, let's say kilograms, the miles per gallon is 48-ish. But if weight is around 3600, miles per gallon drops down to 12, roughly. So there is an inverse relationship. Definitely. But how do we answer that in a precise way? Can we calculate a correlation or the number which we calculated x minus x bar in simple ways and then try to figure this out? I'll share this notebook so that in case you're not able to remember any of the formulas, you can figure it out easily. Okay. So we'll calculate a correlation between these two. There is a simple correlation coefficient between x and y. Okay, I haven't defined x and y. So x I want to define as data MPG, and y I want to define as data weight. Okay, so correlation gives a correlation matrix, because I've just given it two, but you might give it as many as possible, and you saw how it generates a heat map and this. So I can subset this as from zero. This also you should be comfortable in how to subset. If I want to extract only this part, how do I extract it? So zeroth row and first column would give me my correlation coefficient. Now, can we precisely answer the question if there is a relationship between MPG and weight? Yes. What is the relationship? It's a negative relationship is what we can infer. Can we infer strength by how much? Okay. So question two, what I want to ask is, does decreasing weight increase miles per gallon? What do you guys think?
Yes. It would? Yeah.
Okay. So one thing I want you guys to be super clear about is correlation does not imply causality. Correlation just says that for higher weights, we see lower miles per gallon. For lesser weights, we see higher miles per gallon. But it does not tell us that decreasing a weight would cause miles per gallon to go up. It might be because of anything. Perhaps we throw out a lot of parts and engine changes and something happens which drives this up when the weight goes down. But we have no information around that. This correlation only tells that for higher things, for higher y, x is lower. For lower y, x is higher. It does not establish any causal relationship between these. We simply do not have enough information to talk about would driving weight up or down cause changes in miles per gallon. We can generally say that we have a notion of high weights and low miles per gallon, low weights and high miles per gallon. But we cannot say that one causes the other. This is a fundamental mistake many, many trained statisticians also do, where they mistake correlation for causality. So never ever be mix up these things. Correlation is a separate notion. Causality is a separate notion. If we had to test causality, we would have to do some statistical tests like ANOVA, where we take 100 cars out, we measure their miles per gallon, keeping everything same, just decrease the weight and then measure miles per gallon and establish. We have not done anything like that. We have just merely plotted and we have arrived at a notion or an idea that higher weights have something to do, and higher weights somehow coexist with lower miles per gallon. Lower weights coexist with higher miles per gallon. That's all we know. So we can answer questions like, do they have a linear relationship? Yes. Does one causes the other? We don't know. We cannot say about it. We cannot say yes. We cannot answer no. It's just that we don't have information enough about it. So Naseem, was that you who said yes?
Yes, Bharat.
Okay, Naseem. So now you are clear that there is difference between correlation and causality. The question was a little trick question. So correlation would just tell you that higher this would mean that in the given data set, MPGs would be lower and lower weight would mean higher. But one does not cause other. There is a fundamental difference between these. Okay, so what was the next question? If we increase weight of the car, correlation, we simply do not have enough idea. Okay. So now, once we have summarized, okay, our model creates a summary of this, okay, summary of this entire data. And with that summary, we are somehow able to identify a line, the line which we usually see going through the data. We have a summary. And with this summary, we want to predict, like, now we can answer questions like, if car was 4000 LVS, what would be its mileage? Now, this is where linear regression is used. Let's go to our data again. You would see this origin. Now, origin is usually this. So I have this piece of code. Let's go through it. Does the name of car in any way help us with our prediction between this and this, and our question that if weight was 4000 kilos, how do we, what can it be? What can be the miles per gallon? No. So we drop that. Second thing is origin. We don't know what 1, 2, 3, 4 means. So I've subsected origin, and in the origin, I've replaced every 1 with America, every 2 with Europe, every 3 with Asia. And this is how our data would look like. Okay, so I've removed off this column, and in origin, everyone has been replaced with America. Every 2 has been replaced with Europe. Okay, just a quick test. You should remember this. How do we subset? If I want to see all the rows with only origin as Europe, what do I do? Origin equals Europe. So we see this has worked well. Always check your code. Does it have, has it done the same thing as you intended it to? Okay, it seemed to have done exactly what I intended it to. Now, there's something called a dummy variable notion. You remember when I said a computer needs to be fed precise data? Now we know, because of our, perhaps because of various things we have learned, that there is something called America, Europe, Asia. Your system does not know that. Or in fact, whenever you find something which is categorical in nature, in this column, origin is categorical in nature. By categorical, what I mean is it has 3 categories: Europe, America, Asia. Now I have assigned one. The data came with the notion of 1, 2, 3. Now these are numbers. and this is category. One fundamental difference is numbers have some sort of ordinality to it. By ordinality, what I mean is a notion that 2 is greater than 1, 3 is greater than 2, a notion that 2 is twice as 1, and 3 is 1.5 times more than 2 is. So there is some sense, there is a notion that something is bigger, something is smaller. But with these categories, categories are just categories. We cannot say because Asia is 3, it is 3 times more important than America, or 1.5 times more important than Europe, or in the same sequence, Asia is more important than Europe, which is more important than America. But because we have attached numbers to it, your computer algorithm might get fooled and interpret in that way. So we always want to get rid of that. But again, we have gotten rid of it here by replacing these values with this. But how do we tell a computer that these are categories and there is nothing beyond it? So we generally, for every category, we do something called a dummy variable. What dummy variable does is, let me draw it up for you. So if we have a data set, let's say we are predicting a salary of, you have an org chart given to you with various data points. So this is age, this is department, this is number of working hours, this is experience in years, blah, 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 so forth. So age should be 24, 36, something like that. It's a numerical thing. Same way, number of hours, working hours is a number. Number of experiences, department. Let's take an example. Do they work in engineering, marketing, or accounting? Now, this is something called categorical data. What we want to do is somehow put our data set in a way that a computer understands and it does not assign any more undue importance. It's just a category. So what we do is, this department now gets split into 3 columns: engineering, marketing, accounting. So employee number 1, his age was 24. He worked for engineering. This becomes 1, rest becomes 0. And then hours, something, experience, something, so on and so forth. The second one with age 32. Worked for marketing. This becomes 0. Marketing becomes 1. Accounting becomes 0. Same way, whenever you find someone who works for accounting, you turn others 0 and this 1. Now, this concept is utilized to convert categorical variables in a way where computer does not mistake categories for anything else. This concept is called one-hot encoding. Why one hot? Because at any given row, only one of these are hot and rest are off. So either an employee works for engineering or marketing or accounting based on where he works, that element will get hot or one, rest all will become zero. This thing is called one hot encoding. This is what I've done here. It's fairly simple line of code where you say data pd.getDummies and what is the variable from which you get dummies. Okay, so we want our dummies from origin. GetDummies. I pressed Alt Tab to arrive at this help. So it tells me first I have to pass on data. Okay, my data is called data, and then prefix none. I don't want to prefix anything, but however, if there are a lot of columns, you might get confused. You can always prefix. What prefix means is if I put a prefix as X, if this gets broken down into 3 parts, it would be every of those 3 columns would get prefixed with X. So it would be called X_America, X_Europe, something like that. which will help you differentiate. But because of our size of our columns, I don't really need anything. Dummy, NA, columns, none, blah, 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 D type, drop first. Okay, this is an important notion. I'll come to it little later. So I really don't want anything. Oh, okay. So what it has done is, here it has taken horsepower as a categorical nature, and if you see horsepower 46, 48, 49, it has converted that to one hot encoding. This is not what I wanted. So what do I want to turn? Origin. Okay, so you see, I have done pd.getDummies and origin has been one hot encoded. So the first 0th element was America. You will see one here. And 394th element. 394th element was Europe. So 394, Europe is hot, rest are cold. So this is called one hot encoding. And you also know how to concatenate data. So I would leave it to you to sort of do it yourself. But you understand the concept of what I just did. I've just converted this column into this for our computer to be able to understand it. Now we have our data in a way in which we can throw it to a computer. Before that, we have to deal with missing values. We opened it in Excel, and that's why we could see a question mark. But I also showed you generally data is so huge, it's not possible. How do we do that? We saw describe would give convert all the numerical elements and will give you a statistical summary of everything. Miles per gallon, there are 398 rows. Well, there are 398 rows because first one is zero, so 398. It calculated mean, standard deviation. Here you will notice a curious thing. Horsepower has gone missing from here. You have miles per gallon, cylinder, displacement, and weight, and acceleration, and all those. Horsepower has gone missing. Why? I also told you that data.info gives you a better information about things. You see, everything is a number. Float, cylinders is an integer. This is a float. Horsepower is an object, though. Now let's investigate why it is an object. Perhaps it has something mixed in it, which is not a number, and that's why it was detected as an object, and that's why it didn't come up here. Because describe would do a summary only of mathematical or things that have numbers onto it. It might be a float, it might be integer, but this horsepower seems to have something which is not a number, and that's why it's causing that. Okay, let's investigate.
Question mark, Bharat?
Yeah?
Question mark in the data set?
Yeah, question mark. But because we, when we saw it in Excel, we figured out it was a question mark. But I'm assuming that data sets are usually so big that you would never open it in Excel. In that case, all you have to rely is on this. And I'm trying to describe a way by which you will catch these things. So first thing is, I would say describe, and everything that should be a number should come up here. That's where I noticed horsepower wasn't here. So I checked what is the type of data, and that's when I figured out horsepower is not a pure number. So as of now, I'm thinking that it might have something in it which is not a number. So data, horsepower, converting it into a string, and I'm using something called is numeric. Now what it tells me is there is a better way of doing it. Actually, is digit. So what I'm doing here is because I suspect that something in it is a string, I'm trying to put a true or false, whether it's a digit or not. So we have horsepower with some question marks, and I'm trying to figure out what are these. I don't know it as of now because I have not seen the data, and most probably you will never see. Data sets would be huge, and that's what you're trying to figure out, whether what is it that is causing it. So wherever it's false, I want to try to catch that. So I'm subsetting it by first. What did I do? Do you want me to repeat it, or you guys are comfortable doing this? This is same subsetting which we did last time. I can repeat if you guys want.
Yes.
Okay, I'll repeat it once more. So data, I was not sure what horsepower was. Matlab, what I mean to say is, I don't know why it is not numeric. So definitely if it is not numeric, there is some string element of it. Now dot string converts everything into a string. So now I have converted every of the element of horsepower into a string. And then I'm interrogating what parts are digits. Now this would give me whether it's missing or it's a digit. So what I want is what parts, when I say two equal twos, I'm comparing. When is this condition false? That means when is any element in data.horsepower not a number, not a digit? And then so it gives me a sense of, it gives me quickly true or false, true, true, false, 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 like that. If I put it under data, I'm subsetting it, and then I'm arriving only at the rows which are false. So now I see actually horse had something like a question mark, and same way as I replaced these values, I can replace the question mark with something we are more familiar in dealing with. Okay, now this is clear.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay, so I'm just replacing. But let's do it from start. So data dot replace. What do I want to replace? So this with usually not a number. This is what I want to do. I've done that. Replace. So this is the documentation for replace. To replace, I want to replace this with value np.name. In place is false, but I want it to be done in place. Okay. Now if I see data horsepower has converted into float, but it still has missing values. How do I find missing values? This I've showed enough number of times last time, so please be very clear on how to do these things. Data horsepower is null. False, false, false. I want to subset it with whatever is missing. So I'm asking, is it null? Yes, if it is null, then subset it. So it has given me all those things which I have replaced. You see, it would be the same row numbers, 32, 126. Question mark, I replaced with none. Now I also showed you how to replace this by median. This is the mean of horsepower. I can substitute it in this and easily, there are multiple ways of substituting. One is this way, data dot replace, you can do NaN. But easier way is, I showed you last time, how do you impute and how do you substitute values. One more easier way is fill dot NA. Oh, I've just left it here. I'll update it and then share it. Data.fill.na with main. I can store it somewhere and then fill it up with main. What this would do is, if there are any other missing values, it would get filled by the mean value there. And I want it in place. If I don't do in place, it would not affect the original data set. So now my data set should be clear.
Bharat, I have one question.
Yes.
As you have mentioned, like categorizing like Asia, Europe, and at the beginning, for that value also we should be, I mean, like we should give the in place value is equal to true.
Oh, while doing this part? While splitting it from one column to, while doing, yes, one hot encoding.
Yes, that dummy function you use.
Get dummies?
Dummies, yes.
Oh, well, it does it by itself. If I just used this part, pd.getDummies, what it, yes, would do is, it would just give me, I've changed the data set so it doesn't have origin anymore. But if I just use this, what it would give me is, it would give me a separate table of, okay, only this broken down into three columns.
Yes.
But what I'm doing is, data is equal to, so I've changed the entire, this variable, earlier data was pointing to this entire table. Now data points to a table with dummies having data. And what does dummy do? Change this column into multiple dummies.
Okay.
So that's why data was now pointing to, is now pointing to something which is much more expanded. So this is one hot encoded and data now points to that. You see, I've done this, data is equal to. That's why I didn't use is in place. Okay, so we have done our steps. Next step is visualization. So sns.pyplot. This throws up a bivariate distribution that is comparison of one feature to every other feature. This is important. So I usually do it in same order. First, I check the data, fill up any missing values, then try to get an understanding of data by doing a pair plot. So here something interesting comes up. Miles per gallon is somehow very closely related to this displacement, CC. So this also shows a negative relationship. As CC increases, miles per gallon tends to be low. Does one cause other? No, but it's just a correlation. Same way with this variable. Weight, this we have already seen and analyzed. There is some sort of positive relationship here, but it's not as strong as these negative relationships. It's a little scattered, but still there is, it tends to be pointing upwards. This is acceleration. So as a car's acceleration has higher numbers, we tend to see higher miles per gallon, but there is no tight relationship. Now these are categorical, that's why you would see either this or this, because it's either 0 or 1. Okay, this seems to be very, very strongly correlated. This is displacement and weight. So as you see, so actually displacement is engine's displacement, what we also call CC. And we know from our knowledge of cars that because higher, bigger cars would have larger engine sizes and hence more CC. This is what you are seeing here. There is a positive correlation. However, there is something interesting. Displacement comes in chunks. So there is one chunk here. So it seems to be a little discrete. So CC takes a jump. It's not very continuous. So you either have a 100 CC, then comes 150 CC, and then inter. There is usually no 101 cc, 102 cc like that. There you are seeing this. Same thing here. Your weight and displacement. You would see this is a little discrete indicator. There are intermediary, but most of these are concentrated around certain discrete numbers. So I would usually go through these, study these to get an understanding of how the data looks like. Here, cylinder. We have 1, 2, 3 broad categories of cylinders because this is cylinder versus cylinder, diagonal line. But here it tells distribution has 3 broad categories. There are very few with 5 broader categories, with these having very minimal, but most of the data has these. So these might be 3-cylinder, 5-cylinder, 4-cylinder or in 8-cylinder cars. If I want to smoothen these things, I would generally put a kernel density in estimate. So KDE, what it does is it smoothens out the histograms and allows certain things to be viewed in a easier way, intuitive way. So what it has done is those diagonal elements which I showed you, still calculating because there is so much of data. Yeah, here. All the data remains same. It's just these histograms get smoothened out. Now I can see very clearly. There are 3 types of cylinders. There are 1, 2, 3. Broadly 3 types where data is concentrated. 3 broad displacement areas. You see 2 peaks. This is origin America. Yes, no, as expected. Acceleration has some center. So most of the acceleration trends around this point and then it tapers off. And it looks like a Gaussian distribution, which has very good properties to work on. So it allows me to build an intuition on what is the data set that I'm working on. Okay. With this done, let's start doing our work. First thing, as I said, we split our data into train and testing set, and I explained the reason why. Now, how do you do that? First, we need to identify our independent variables and dependent. Same thing as predictors and predicted. In data, our predicted is miles per gallon, and all these become features or predictors. So it's just generally convention that Y is denoted as what is predicted and X is, because it's a, there are multiple ways to do this. Either I can do this. This would mean from first column, I'm ignoring zeroth. So X would mean data from first column till the end. Or I can do data dot drop. And what is that I'm dropping? MPG. In place equal to true. So obviously you will always see that there are multiple ways of doing same thing in Python mostly. So let's say to see whether we have done it correctly. Y is data 1815, yes. X is right, miles per gallon, cylinder and all. Okay. So here I've also dropped one particular column, origin Europe. I'll give an intuition on why. I need to go back to my drawing board for that. Okay, so what we did essentially was we have a column, we have this data, and we have one column which is categorical, and we want to break this column down into multiple columns. In here, this was country of make. So we have Europe, Asia, and America. We have something that looks like this. Now, we if you see, we don't need three variables to represent all the information contained in this. So if Europe and Asia are zero, it's implicit that it's America, right? So we could have just used these two, Europe, Asia, and then either put a 01, that means it's Asia, or 10, that means it's Europe, or 00, which implicitly means it's neither Europe nor Asia, implicitly implying that the make is America. So usually for a categorical variable with n number of categories, we first use pd.getDummy. To break it down to n columns. From these n columns, we just drop anyone. It doesn't matter which one, we can drop anyone to end up with n minus 1 columns. That is what I've done here, because we don't need all the n columns to identify information. So let me just copy this. So here I have dropped miles per gallon because miles per gallon was Y. And then I have dropped origin Europe. It could have been anything, origin America or origin Europe. It really wouldn't matter. So I can drop anything. And if you see this data.getDummies when we did that, make it will do that. Here. So in here, if I check the documentation, I need not do that separately. In the documentation, I can see first I provide the data on which I need to work, whether do I want a prefix or not, the column which needs to be dummy, and then it has drop first is equal to false. If I did this, drop first is equal to true, it will by default drop one of the columns. So it would by default, what it would do is what I am doing it now. It will by default give me only those two columns. So it will give me only Asia and Europe. It would by default drop America. Or it's random. You cannot actually tell which column to drop. But if you had, let's say, four categories, it would drop one random category. It would just create three dummy categories, because that's all we need to predict anything. So I've dropped origin America, no particular choice. Why only America? It could have been anything. From access one, I wanted to drop columns and miles per gallon. Notice I have put two of these instead of one. The difference is, okay, it looks like this. Compare this to this. $398, one column. Here, $398, comma, and it's left blank. You have subsected it. You have just selected one piece of information. The way your algorithms would expect information most of the time is when it has both these available, number of columns and number of rows. So remember this, even if you don't, most of the algorithms will work because they're smart, but in case some of your algorithms don't work, most common mistake is this. Okay, so we have X and Y split. Okay, now how do we split test and train? There are multiple ways. One way is you shuffle all of these three, shuffle the entire data set and randomly select a percentage of this, or use a library. I tend to use the scikit-learn library a lot. So from sklearn.linearmodel import.
one basic question.
So
we are modifying the data and all that, whatever we have taken from the Excel sheet, correct?
Right.
And we have modified and we have created our own data set. Can we again pull back into the Excel?
In sense, can I do this again? Can I this line again?
No. What I'm trying to, so Excel sheet, we have a number of rows, we have a number of columns.
Export it to Excel.
Yeah, can I export into the Excel?
Can you export this into Excel after conversion? Like right now, our data looks like this. You want to export this into Excel?
Correct.
PD to Excel or what is this data? Excel. Now I want to call it data. If I go back to my folder, you see new data.
Okay, fine.
You see this, actually I have done something. Okay, perhaps I have not copied the, or I have done something which has gone wrong. It usually, all the question marks are replaced by something else and not median. But any which ways, you guys now know to do that. Let's do it from the start. Okay, here you are actually, I am importing one specific library. Two, in fact, these two you have not seen. I'm importing linear regression model from a library called sklearn, scikit-learn. Now this is a beautiful library. Most of the supervised learning and supervised learning, you have all the models pre-built. So if you Google for scikit-learn and press enter, the first thing that you see, scikit-learn.org. You would have this, you can have a user's guide. It would have everything, linear model, whatever. So the documentation is also designed very nicely. It will tell the history, the theory behind it. It will give an example of how to use it. It will tell you all the ways to use it. Quite an exhaustive documentation. And mostly we will be using this for next 6 months, this library. So whenever you have any trouble using, just like how we relied on Seaborn and Matplotlib documentation, I would suggest you just Google this and go back to this as much as you can whenever you have any issues working on that. Second, from the same library, I have imported something called a test terrain split. Now I have used this scikit-learn linear model import linear regression. Now this all will become just like how we used Matplotlib pyplot PLT. Linear regression comes from a library called linear model. Linear model has multiple algorithms in it. One of the algorithms is linear regression, but this is a standard way. Most of the time you would just copy paste this from somewhere else. So this is how it would be. For splitting, I'm using from same scikit-learn model selection, I'm using test terrain split. Don't worry about memorizing these things. You will do it so many times that it will, just like how now you use type this intuitively, you'll start typing this intuitively. Same, I'm loading my data. What happened? It does not exist. Okay. It's not a CSV file, it's an XLS file. I think I've done something to this Excel and ended up corrupting it. Okay, I forgot it. What I'm doing wrong. Okay. Head same set dummy variables describe, and I'm just removing all the question marks with median. As type converting it into float, drawing plots, which we have done. Split. Okay. So first I have defined x and y. And now what I do is I pass this. Okay, let's see what these x and y are. Y is just column of all MPG and x is rest of the data. You see, I have just kept two and dropped URM. Okay. What I would do is I would use this library. So it works like this. Train test split. If I check the documentation, split an array or matrices into random train and test subsets. This is what I want to do. So what does it expect me to do? It takes arrays and some options. Okay, I just have to pass x and y. So this is the format in which I have to pass on the data. I've just copied it from the documentation. So I have my x, which is this, and I have my y, which I have defined. I have test size. This means what should be the percentage of my test data set and what should be the percentage of my train. So I usually take, depending on the data size, so if I have a lot, so think of it this way. Usually I keep 80% available for my training and 20% to test. But if data is small, I want significant amount of it to be left over for test. So in this case, I've decided 30, but usually this would not matter much. But ideally 80-20 is called a good ratio. Some people follow 70-30. I follow 80-20. When the data sets are large, so doesn't matter. Random state. You remember last time we discussed about random state, whenever we are generating random numbers for this to be predictable, we just assign it a random state. So, and then this breaks it into four parts. X train, X test, because we had X variable. So part of it will become training, part of it will become test. Same way, Y, part of it will become train, part of it will become test. Let's run this. And then if we see X underscore train. Now this is a standard step for all the libraries. This is the shape. This is the shape. Let's see the shape of our original data set. So 278 plus 120, 398, exactly matching. So this has broken this in a ratio of 70 to 30, 70% going to train and 30% left over for test. Purely done randomly. Same way, Y. X had 8 columns, so this shows 8. Y has only 1 column because it's just MPG. 278, 120, these numbers should be same. Okay, so we have broken our data set into X train, X test, Y train, Y test. Regardless of the application, you will always see the same thing. Now, all we have to do for linear regression is take a variable and call linear regression. So here we have done linear regression is equal to regression model and done this variable dot fit. What are we fitting this model on? Train sets. So X train and Y train. And then what I want is. I want coefficients of this. So what are these coefficients? Remember when I said the entire purpose of the model was to draw a straight fit line, best fit line. So we have X and Y with this data, X, Y, and we drew a line. This line looked like something like 0.9 times X plus 1 is equal to Y. Now this is called a coefficient. This is your feature and this is your predicted. These are your predictors or features. If you have multiple features, you would have an equation like Y is equal to A times predictor 1, feature 1 plus B times feature 2 plus C times feature 3. These features are same thing as these. So A times cylinder 1 plus B times displacement plus C times horsepower plus D times weight and all that. So that A, B, C is what it has calculated as this. Because we cannot visualize more than three dimensions, it has just given us number and not a graph. So essence of it, we have calculated this equation. And now we are able to predict. Given x1, x2, x3, and a, b, c, d, we are able to calculate y. So this is, in essence, a regression model. So I'm a little mindful that this session has gone way too longer than intended. Usually we end by 3, it's 3:30. So I will make this, I've covered most of the things which I wanted to cover. I will save this notebook and you can ignore the interaction term. So I've covered it till here. I'll put some material also on the webpage. So go through it and next week again, we will go through one example end to end. This week we spent a lot of time on theory. Next week I'll run through an example end to end and cover this slide deck. And by next week end, next week when we start, we will cover one data set. This would be on California prices. We'll put a linear regression and we'll try to predict the price. We'll work through that example end to end. Meanwhile, this week I'll update this material, so you will find this in the week 5 section. Go through all the material which I would update here. I'll do it today evening mostly. So, and unless any questions, I'll see you next week. If you have any questions while you are practicing this, feel free to message or text me anytime.
So, Bharat, just one thing.
Yeah.
Bharat, just one thing. In the example that you were just showing, I mean, now you just showed us the fit. Can you just, just take 2 minutes to explain the test part as well? I mean, you've trained it, right? You've trained it and you've gotten the coefficients. Now, how do you test it, basically?
Yeah, so that is what I wanted to cover this part. I just got here until the testing part on how do we fit a model, just to tie back to all the theory that we have learned. There are certain more things which I wanted to explain, like how are we sure these numbers are, how are we sure that these numbers which the model has arrived are the best possible numbers before I wanted to start with the model.predict, predicting it or testing it.
Okay. Understood. Okay.
So there is some more theory on how are we sure these numbers are the best numbers and how do we these are numbers. How do we visually confirm these numbers? What do they look like and what do they mean? I wanted to cover that and then go to the prediction part. I'll do that next week.
Yeah, understood. Thanks, Bharat. Yeah.
I know this is fairly new because we have just started with machine learning, but again, as with anything else, we would do it so many times that it would become second nature. Feel free to reach out to me anytime. Practice more than anything. I will update all the material, go through it. If you have any questions, ask me. But this becomes foundation of our machine learning. By next weekend, you should be able to create your own model on most of the data sets and be able to predict things. So we've covered quite a lot of ground. I think by next week would be truly interesting when you create your own model. I think we will cover linear regression and I'll put a timeline on by what part you can expect to start taking your own data sets and start building on it. Okay, any more questions? If not, then thanks for today's time, and then I guess I'll see you next week. I'll upload all the material for next week by today evening. Practice every day. I'll put the same in the same format: day one, day two, day three, day four, day five. Go through these, and we should be able to pick up one end-to-end example. And by next week, you should be able to start using machine learning, at least the linear regression algorithm, and then build up our repository of algorithms that we know. Okay. So thanks all for your time.
Thanks, Bharat. Thanks.
Thank you, Bharat.
Thank you, Bharat. Thank you.